السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلاما عليك يا سيدي يا حبيبي يا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. All praises due to Allah, the Creator, the Sustainer. Peace, blessings and salutations upon the greatest of His creation, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, we have previously been discussing in regard to the seerah of the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And we have managed to complete 7 chapters of our discussion. And moving on with the 8th chapter of the seerah of the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. In this chapter, we will discuss the 3rd year after migration. And in this 3rd year after migration, the biggest event was the Battle of Uhud. Of course, there are many other incidents which took place and events took place in the 3rd year after migration. But inshallah, we will cover whatever we can in this 8th chapter, which is the 3rd year after migration. So as the biggest event of the 3rd year after migration was the Battle of Uhud, I feel it important that we start discussing in regard to this battle. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Uhud is the name of a mountain 3 miles from Madinatul Munawwara. And the Battle of Uhud was named as the Battle of Uhud because it took place within close proximity. And it has also been mentioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala several times in the Holy Quran. As we have previously learned in regard to the Battle of Badr, and we learned that 70 kuffar were killed in Badr and 70 were arrested. And the majority of those killed were leaders, or rather rulers of the kuffar of the Quraysh, which led to every individual of Makkah, including women and children, to seek revenge for the killing of their fellow men to an extent that their lives would feel incomplete without this revenge. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, the majority who were killed were leaders, or rather rulers of the kuffar of the Quraysh, which led to every individual of Makkah, including women and children, to seek revenge to an extent that their lives would feel incomplete without fully doing so. And a distinguishing characteristic of the Arabs, notably the Quraysh, was that they would avenge each killing of their fellow men to an extent that their lives would feel incomplete without doing so. And for this reason, they had decided that this, because the reason that the leaders and those who are rulers of the kuffar of the Quraysh who were killed in the Battle of Badr, for that reason, this task of avenging each killing of their fellow men, this task should be carried out as soon as possible. These were the thoughts of the kuffar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Ikrama, the son of Abu Jahl, Safwan, the son of Umayyah, and other disbelievers of the Quraysh whose family had been killed in Badr, approached Abu Sufyan and said that the Muslims have killed our leaders and family. To take vengeance is a national responsibility, and we therefore wish for all profit made from businesses this year to be collected for a war budget. With it, we can buy weapons, armor, and other vital items for battle. And in doing so, we will prepare a strong army and be able to attack Medina to eliminate the existence of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and the Muslims from the face of the earth. Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we are learning the reason of the battle of Uhud. And you must know that the main reason was the 70 killed and the 70 arrested in the Battle of Badr. And we've learned in regard to what Safwan and Ikrama are saying to Abu Sufyan, that vengeance is a national responsibility. And when Abu Sufyan heard this, that all the profit made from businesses should be collected for a war budget and to create a strong army, he happily accepted their request. But after the Battle of Badr, why were they planning in this manner? Because the kuffar were aware that it was no easy task. Indeed, to go against the forces of nature was easy, but to challenge the followers of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was something that they were not prepared enough for. And for that reason, they spent every coin in purchasing extra weapons and additional supplies for war. And they enlisted the help of poets to create an emotion of war and revenge within the Arab tribes by their rendition of poetry as well. And who are those people responsible for this poetry? Amr Jami and Masafi were two such poets that taught the Arab tribes, gaining support for their impending war against the Muslims. Through their eloquent speech and poems, they were able to win the people over for the cause of the Quraysh, and a large army was assembled consisting of men and women from prominent families, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam. And it was for this reason, that Wahshi, the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im, was trained by Hind. Wahshi, the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im, was trained by Hind to slay Sayyid al-Shuhada, Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And what was the reason that he trained Wahshi? It was for this reason that the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im was trained by Hind to slay Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as he had killed her father Utbah, as well as the uncle of Jubair ibn Mut'im. Hind, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, understand that Utbah was the father of Hind, and also the uncle was killed in the Battle of Badr by Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and so was Utbah. So the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im, whose uncle was killed in the Battle of Badr by Hazrat Hamza, Wahshi, the slave of Jubair ibn Mut'im, was trained by Hind to slay Hazrat Hamza, and he had killed her father. Whose father? Hind's father, who was Utbah. As well as Hazrat Hamza had killed the uncle of Jubair ibn Mut'im. And what was the reward for Wahshi? That in return for him killing Hazrat Hamza, she would certainly see that he be freed. Hind would certainly see that Wahshi was freed. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, such planning. We will learn as to what happened with Sayyid al-Shuhada, Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But you can see that how they were now preparing just for the revenge of the Battle of Badr. And after much emotion and preparation, The Kufar army of Makkah made for Medina to attack the Muslims was commanded by Abu Sufyan. And at that time, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, as we learned in regard to him as well whilst discussing, he was confidentially still a Muslim living in Makkah. And he wrote a letter to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, notifying him of the kuffar's assembling of an army and their march towards Medina for attack. And on the 5th of Shawwal, in the third year after migration, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam received this letter and sent Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Munis radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the two sons of Hazrat Adi bin Fadala radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as informants to gather information regarding this. And after they returned, they informed the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam that the army of Abu Sufyan was within close proximity to Medina, in the vicinity of Arid, the patch of Medina, and that the army's horses had eaten the grass of it as well. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, from this we learn that Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, was confidentially still living as a Muslim in Makkah. And he wrote the letter to the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And surely the information was true, as they had reached the vicinity of Arid, which was the pasture of Medina. And after receiving this information, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has now received the information after he sent Hazrat Anas and Munis radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in to go and gather information. And when they gave this information, the security of Medina was intensified. And on the night before the 14th of Shawwal, in the third year after migration, Hazrat Sa'd ibn Mu'az, Asid ibn Adir, and Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, fully armed, guarded the house of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, whilst they were also assisted by other Ansaris. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, other guards had also been placed in important parts of the city, as the security of Medina was in great need to be intensified. And in the morning, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam gathered both the Ansar and the Muhajirin to discuss whether the army should be faced in Medina or the Muslims directly meet their challenge out of it. The majority of the Muhajirin, as well as certain elderly Ansar, thought that the women and children should be locked in the forts whilst the men resist their attack within the city. And this was also agreed by the leader of the Munafiqs, Abdullah ibn Ubay, who was in the meeting as well. And there had also been a few young Ansaris who were not present in the Battle of Badr and unable to contain the passion of jihad. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, they were spurred to declare statements that it's necessary for us to leave Medina to fight the Kufar army. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, understand that he is the beloved of Allah, he can make a decision, but he's teaching us as the Ummah to discuss. That is why we as a family, when we have, without comparison, just something which came to my mind now, that we as a family, when we live today, we should make sure that we make mashwara, we discuss with our family before we take decisions. As the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, this is the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. May Allah guide us to follow his sunnah. Understand that as they were all gathered, the Muhajireen and the Ansar, they gave their discussion, they gave their views in regard to the woman and the children being locked in forts. And also Abdullah bin Ubay, the leader of the Munafiqs, was also in a meeting. But after listening to every opinion, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam went to his house, dressed himself in his armor for battle and came out. Outside, it was agreed by the Sahaba that the kuffar should be met from within, within the city of Medina. And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam learned that after listening to everyone, went inside the house, dressed himself in armor for battle and came out. And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said that it is unbecoming for a prophet to wear his armor for war and later remove it before Allah decides his and his enemy's fate. Allahu Akbar. And you should take the name of Allah and proceed to the battlefield. Indeed, if each of you fight bravely, He, Allah, will grant us victory. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we can learn from the meeting and the mashwara and the discussion which took place between the Ansar and the Muhajireen and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, as we learned, got dressed and he said that it cannot come off until Allah decides the fate of him and the enemies. And therefore, he gave, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, gave the flag of the Khazraj tribe to Hazrat Habbab bin Munzir and the flag of the Aus tribe to Hazrat Asid bin Habir and the flag of the Muhajireen to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And the army which proceeded out of Medina to intercept the oncoming army of the Kuffar consisted of 1,000. But as Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam exited the city, he noticed another army coming along and inquired as to who they were. And he was told that they are Jews, the Halifs. We learn the meaning of Halif. The Halifs of Abdullah ibn Ubay, the leader of the Munafiqs, and have come to help us in the battle. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam replied, that tell them to go back to Medina. We do not require the help of mushriks to fight mushriks. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has told an army which was brought by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, which was brought by the leader of the Munafiqs, Abdullah bin Ubay. And there were 300 soldiers with him to fight for Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Seeing the help of the Jews being refused, he returned to Medina with his fighters, saying, Muhammad did not accept my wish and has come out of Medina to meet with the Makkah army against my opinion. I shall not support him. That was the statement of the leader of the Munafiq, Abdullah bin Ubay. Hearing this, the Banu Salma of the Khazraj and the Banu Haritha of the Aus tribe desired to go back to Medina. But however, Allah had created a great love for Islam within them, which could not now shake their resolution to participate in jihad. And Allah mentions in the Holy Quran that إِذْهَمَّ الطَّائِفَتَانِ مِنْكُمْ أَن تَفْشَلَ وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّهُمَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. When two of your groups intended cowardness, but Allah is their supporter, and upon Allah should the Muslims rely, إذ هم الطائفتان منكم أن تفشل والله وليهما وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون. سبحان الله, الله أكبر. The Quran mentions of this, that when two of your groups intended cowardness, but Allah is their supporter, and upon Allah should the Muslims rely. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, now, what did the army consist of? The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam now had an army of 700 companions, with only 100 of them fully armored. And remember that they were against an army of 3,000 kuffar consisting of 700 fully armored soldiers, 200 on horseback, and 3,000 camels, along with also 15 women. Allahu Akbar. The Muslims are 700 with only 100 of them armored, while the kuffar are 3,000 and consisted of 700 fully armored. Allahu Akbar. It is surely a brave situation and a brave decision to go with an army against an army of 3,000. But he was the Prophet of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. In the Battle of Badr, we also learned that the reviewing of the army was done. And after leaving Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inspected his army and ordered all those still young for battle to return to the city, as children do not belong. The children do not belong to the acts of war. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, when he reviewed and the children were told that they don't belong and they don't have to come to the warfare, Hazrat Rafi bin Khadij radiallahu ta'ala anhu was told to return for being too young. In the Battle of Badr, we learned in regard to Hazrat Umair ibn Abu Waqas, and in this one, Hazrat Rafi bin Khadij radiallahu ta'ala anhu was told to return being too young. He began to stand on his toes, Allahu Akbar, to gain height, which earned him a place in the army, subhanallah. Being young, they were able to sacrifice. They know that they are going in a battle. They are not going to a place where they will be treated properly. They are going to face enemies of Islam, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam. Hazrat Rafi bin Khadij stands on his toes to gain height, which earned him a place in the army. But in those children, there was a Hazrat Samura radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was also a young teenager and was told to return back. But he answered that I've defeated Rafi in wrestling, and if permission can be given to him, it can also be given to me. Both were then made to wrestle, and indeed Hazrat Samura radiallahu ta'ala anhu was able to beat Hazrat Rafi, which led to both being allowed to participate in the battle. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, at such a young age, the spirit of Islam. May Allah guide us all, inshaAllah. Continuing, the mushrikeen had by now arrived at the mountain of Uhud near Medina, and they pitched camp on Wednesday the 12th of Shawwal in the third year after migration. But the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam only left the city of Medina on the 14th of Shawwal after the Jum'ah Salah. And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam spent the night at Banu Najjar and reached Uhud at the time of Fajr Salah on Saturday, the 15th of Shawwal. And as he arrived at the time of Fajr Salah, Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave the azan, whereas Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam led the congregation for Fajr Salah. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, I have mentioned this on many occasions, but when we travel, do we assure of reading our salah? do we prepare that we are traveling? We should plan that way we will read our salah. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam going to a war is teaching us that he's facing enemies. As Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu gives the azan and he leads the congregation of Fajr Salah. Subhanallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving us a lesson, and may Allah guide us to follow this lesson of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thereafter, he proceeded, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam headed towards the battlefield to fortify it, and appointed the following companions, which I will mention as generals of the soldiers on the battlefield. Hazrat Ukasha bin Muhsin was to lead the right wing. Hazrat Abu Salma ibn Abdul Asad Makhzumi was to lead the left. Hazrat Ubaidah bin Jarrah and Hazrat Sa'd ibn Abu Waqqas were to lead the forward contingent. And Hazrat Miqdad ibn Umar was to lead the rear contingent. Just to summarize it again, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam headed towards the battlefield to fortify it and appointed the companions as generals of the soldiers on the battlefield. Hazrat Ukasha bin Muhsin was to the right wing. Hazrat Abu Salma ibn Abdul Asad was to the left wing. Hazrat Ubaidah ibn Jarrah and Hazrat Sa'd ibn Abu Waqqas were to lead the forward contingent, and Hazrat Miqdad ibn Umar to lead the rear contingent. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam aligned his battle lines against the Uhud mountain with their backs facing it. The backs were facing the Uhud mountain, and the hill of Ainain was on his left. Understand that the back of the Uhud, the backs were facing the Uhud mountain when the lines were made, and the hill of Ainain was on the left, and there was also a narrow road going through the mountain of Uhud to the rear of the army, which could also be used by the kuffar of the Quraysh to attack the Muslims. And due to this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed of 50 archers to guide it, to guard it. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, understand that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam aligned the lines where the backs were facing towards the mountain of Uhud, and the hill of Ainain was on the left, and there was also a narrow road going through the mountain of Uhud to the Quraysh of the army, near to the rear of the army. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, there was a narrow road going through the mountain of Uhud to the rear of the army, which could also be used by the kuffar of the Quraysh to attack the Muslims. And due to this, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam appointed a division of 50 archers to guard it, placing Hazrat Abdullah bin Jubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu in command, saying, if we are defeated or even victorious, your division should not move from this spot until I send someone to tell you to leave. Understand, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, this is an important point which we will discuss later on. The 50 archers were made to guide, to guard, 50 archers were made to guard the narrow road going through the mountain of Uhud to the rear of the army, which could also be used by the kuffar of the Quraysh. And Hazrat Abdullah ibn Jubair radiallahu ta'ala anhu was in command, and the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam said to him that if we are defeated or even victorious, your division should not move from this spot until I send someone to tell you to leave. This was in regard to the battlefield preparation of the Muslims. Coming to the Mushrikeen, they had also prepared the battle lines very strategically. And the generals on the battlefield were Khalid bin Walid was the commander on the right wing, Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl on the left, Safwan ibn Umayyah in command of the horseback division, and Abdullah bin Rabia in command of the archer division. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Khalid bin Walid in command of the right wing, Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl of the left, Safwan bin Umayyah, commander of the horseback division, and Abdullah bin Rabia, commander of the archer division. Talha bin Abu Talha from the tribe of Banu Abdiddar was the flag bearer of the entire Kuffar army. We learned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had made one from amongst the Khazraj tribe as the flag bearer. and he had made one from the Aus tribe as the flag bearer. In that manner, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, that was the flag bearing of the Muslims. But in the Kufar, Talha bin Abu Talha from the tribe of Banu Abdiddar was the flag bearer of the entire Kufar army. After seeing that the flag bearer of the Kufar was a single individual from the tribe of Banu Abdiddar, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam also appointed Hazrat Mus'ab bin Umair radiyallahu ta'ala anhu as a single flag bearer of the Muslims. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, this has brought us to the end of Uhud part 1 and chapter 8 part 1. And we have covered many aspects in regard to where is Uhud, the reason of the battle of Uhud. We learned in regard to the planning of the Kuffar, the rejection of the help of the Jews. Thereafter, the children who were spirited for war. We have also learned how the battlefield was prepared. And inshallah, in Uhud part 2, we will learn in regard to how the war begins. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me if I have made any mistake during the recitation of the Quran, the translation of the Quran, the narration of the hadith, taking the names of the companions, or anything which I have mentioned in the seerah. If I have made any mistake anyway, I ask Allah to forgive me for that mistake. I make tawbah. If I have made any mistake, I am making tawbah and asking Allah to accept my tawbah. If I have made any mistake, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, I ask Allah to accept whatever has been said and make it a means of guidance for all of us. May Allah guide us to follow the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah guide us to perform our 5-time salah with jamaat. May Allah guide us to be practicing Muslims and sacrifice time for the sake of Islam. And may Allah grant us the opportunity that when we leave from this world, we leave with the kalima, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, wa ma tawfiqi illa billah, astaghfirullah, wa akhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuhu.